Hey, congrats, you got the job. You rolled a nat 20 on the interview check, and now you are sitting pretty with a fresh fang data science job. But is expectation gonna match to reality? Stay tuned until the end to find out. My name is Andrew. I'm a data scientist here in Silicon Valley, coach and a mentor and a YouTuber, as it turns out. That is Professor Meatball. He's a doctorate from Cornell. I have a feeling you're going to want to listen to what I have to say until the end, because I'm going to cover the top three biggest changes from reality to expectation. I'll be covering frequently asked questions like, what are the hours like? What is the work-life balance? How do I smash the like button for the YouTube algorithm and hit that subscribe button if I'm new? And without further ado, let's get going. When you think about data science from the ground up, it is a very unique field that combines statistics, machine learning, modeling, experimentation, Python, SQL, and a lot of different elements that I don't even have the time to list. Although I could do a 10-minute long video where I just list exactly what goes into a data science crockpot. However, the very first expectation versus reality mismatch is the fact that you might expect that you'll come into a FAANG company and start making waves automatically. You might think that engineers have direct relationships with you that ask for your advice, your statistical know-how for every single A/B test or any product that they're trying to engineer and any feature they're trying to roll out. That is not what exactly happens. The first thing you'll learn is that data scientists are often siloed into different engineering teams. That means one data scientist could be serving an entire 20-person engineering team or 30-person, 50-person, 100-person team. That kind of is a crazy ratio. One person to 100 people who need to bend that person's ear and make sure that everything in the company is running smoothly. Surprisingly, this comes with its own mismatch of pros and cons. The pro here is that you are essentially someone who fixes the fire engine when a fire comes out. You're going to be able to help the fire engine run more efficiently. You're going to help future fires get detected faster, but you are not on the ground floor when a fire is actually happening. A data scientist is rarely called in at 9 p.m., 12 a.m., 2 a.m. to solve a life or death engineering issue. So that first big mismatch of exactly how much agency you have in the company comes from the idea that data scientists are always assumed to be thought leaders, assumed to have the statistical rigor to drive decisions, but oftentimes it is the reverse. In companies that either have built new data science teams or data science teams are kind of in their infancy, data scientists are essentially data moms or data maids. You're taking a lot more of a reactionary stance when it comes to data solutions and problems. When there is a problem to be had, like a leak to be sprung, you have to patch it instead of trying to look for leaks to begin with. Prevention, detection, and streamlining come at a more advanced data science team, something akin to a 15 to 20 person team, all with its own hierarchy and specific documents and goals in mind. If your data science team has vision, maybe there's a director of data science, maybe there's someone who is actually calling the shots and trying to get you through a sprint, just like how a product manager could try to help an engineering team get through a sprint, then you would be in better shape to start driving agency. Then there's the caveat of your own word being diluted in a sea of other statisticians and data scientists. Come with the expectation that you will be an expert in the room, but you might be one expert out of many, or if you are a minority in a larger team, you might end up having your words fall on deaf ears. Number two is important to note, because this is something I already briefly talked about in the beginning of this video, which is work-life balance. You're probably expecting to work a lot of hours. In fact, engineers end up working a ton of hours depending on how important their specific sprint is and what their role is. The expectation mismatch is between data scientists and engineers. Engineers end up working a ton of hours because they are, once again, like the analogy of firefighters, they're the ones on the ground floor fixing problems and building new solutions. They are the ones that are ending up working 50, if not 80 hour work week. Now that's a big stretch, but we want to have a 95% confidence interval here. On the other hand, if your data science team has well planned out work-life balance, you might end up working only what is necessary, working in day by day, sprint by sprint, progress. This involves creating and testing solutions at your own pace, which allows data science to be a lot more lenient on the work-life balance, probably ending up somewhere closer to 30 to 40 hours a work week, if even that. This means more time with your dog, more time to roll these metal dice that might hurt if they fall in your hand really hard, and more time to create educational videos and create mentorships and other ways to fulfill your life. This mismatch comes as a surprise because this is a pro. In fact, it comes at a big competitive technical field when people are making six-figure entry-level salaries, but also double that when it comes to stock options, and yet you're not even working as hard as your run-of-the-mill consultant, having to fly all over the world and having to answer questions to different stakeholders every single month. No, no, no. You're gonna be working for a solid team, someone who you are gonna build relationships with, and you're gonna be able to understand a product very well so that you can move up the ladder for any kind of specialization you wanna do in the future. For that, I would say work-life balance gets a big A+ for data scientists. Now, a caveat is that not always the case for every single data science specialization. This is just a general understanding. Our third and final expectation and reality mismatch is how much actual modeling and cutting edge technology are you actually working with. If you're an entry level data science position in a FAANG company especially, you're probably gonna be kissing goodbye to all of that theoretical modeling and mathematics that you learned in college. This is likely not gonna be your day to day. If anything, it's gonna be something you gut check every once in a while, maybe a month at a time, whether or not you're tuning the right hyperparameters and having to read a white paper to make sure that you're doing the right thing. If you are an entry level position, you're likely gonna have to leave that to more senior positions, people who look at your code and approve it. And that said, a lot of your time is gonna be spent individual contributions. You're gonna be writing SQL code for the most part if you're working in a company that has fewer data engineers. And if you're more of a data stakeholder business in between person, then you're gonna end up doing a lot of Excel work. So if you're hoping to do some theoretical Python modeling, building out different hyperparameters, tuning them, grid search CV, then you probably wanna aim for a position like a research scientist or perhaps a machine learning engineer. Those are gonna be a little more competitive, especially since they're looking especially for someone with an engineering background or a very technical academic background. But if you wanted that kind of lifestyle, a data scientist might just end up not being technical enough for your liking. Wait just a second, I'm actually not quite done yet because I have a special announcement. I'm starting my own hashtag, thanks inspired to 66 Days of Data by Ken G. I'm gonna start 60 Seconds to Data Science, which means I'm gonna start, as you might have guessed from yesterday's video, I'm going to start 60 second shorts for how to learn SQL, Python, and other important data science interview questions that people seem to get wrong even after hours, weeks, months of bootcamp and entire master's degrees in PhDs. For some reason, people just don't teach that stuff in school anymore. This is inspired by my comment that anybody can learn SQL in 24 hours. So eventually, with enough 60 seconds, we'll build up to 24 hours. One day, by 2035, I suppose. And then you can watch the entire playlist and understand exactly what goes into a data science job. Furthermore, I want to introduce someone special.
Wait, no, this is not how I wanted to...
Finally, I'm gonna explain all of these concepts to someone who is completely non-technical, who is not a data scientist. My girlfriend. By the end of all of these videos, you will be able to understand data science from A to Z, and I hope to join you there. So that's it, this is a quickie. I wanted to make sure you guys know that I am trying to create some new content on TikTok. Over on TikTok, I'm creating 15 second videos. Maybe I'll start increasing their length, but really it's just me picking up my phone, saying exactly what comes to mind and making sure that the information that I put out there is as juicy and packed full of facts and figures and useful hacks as I possibly can. If you're new here, once again, I would really appreciate you following me on a couple of places, including right down below as a subscriber for my channel. But I'm also very active on Instagram if you want to follow me there. Every single tag is the same. And if you want to know a little bit more about how a mentor works and how a mentorship is set up, then I recommend you coming down to the free Discord where you can contact me directly and talk to other peers exactly like you. Let's throw up that list of patrons who help support my transition from data scientist to full-time data science educator. Today, I want to shout out Goliath59NPH. This person is constantly giving great energy into the Discord server, giving great energy into the comment section of my videos. If you want to be shouted out, go ahead and head to Patreon. I take all the comments on my videos, my community posts, and my Instagram, put them in a random number generator, and I'm starting to pick one person a week. And ultimately that's gonna end up being one person a month or maybe even one person every couple of months. So if you want that, you know what to do. As always, for now but not for forever, peace. Talk to you guys later.